Good morning, everyone. This is Dr. Adel Bondok, Professor of Anatomy and Neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. I will talk about the anatomy of the cerebellum. The cerebellum, start by the gross features of the cerebellum. The cerebellum is formed of a central part called the vermis. This is the vermis, the central part. And the peripheral part called the cerebellar hemisphere. So the cerebellum is formed of vermis and the two cerebellar hemispheres. This is the superior surface, this is the inferior surface. Okay, so central part called vermis and the two peripheral parts, okay, called the cerebellar hemispheres. This is a section of the vermis. The part of the vermis on the superior surface is called the superior vermis. And the part of the vermis on the inferior surface is called the inferior vermis. And the vermis is formed of 9 lobules. The lobules of the superior vermis are lingula, central lobule, culmen, declive, and fulium. The vermis, the lobules of the inferior vermis are this is a tuber, pyramid, uvula, and nodule. We have to concentrate on the nodule, uvula, and the pyramid, because the fissure between the nodule and the uvula is called the uvulonodular fissure. Okay? So the vermis is formed of 9 lobules. The cerebellum has 2 notches. This is the anterior notch. This anterior notch surrounds the brainstem. This is the brainstem, so this is the anterior notch. And a posterior notch. This is a posterior notch, contains falx cerebelli. So anterior notch surrounds the brainstem. Posterior notch contains falx cerebelli. This is the vermis. This is the cerebellar hemisphere. And this is the brainstem. Actually, this is the midbrain. Cross cerebri, substantia nigra, tegmentum, and this is the cerebral aqueduct of Sylvius. And this is the medulla, and this is the pons, okay, brainstem. Anterior vermis surrounds the brainstem. Then the cerebellum has many fissures, but let us concentrate on 3 fissures. This fissure on the superior surface is called the primary fissure. This primary fissure separates the anterior lobe from the posterior lobe. So the first fissure is primary fissure on the superior surface. It separates the anterior lobe from the posterior lobe. Another fissure present on the inferior surface between the nodule and the uvula. This is the uvulonodular fissure or posterolateral fissure. This posterolateral fissure separates the folliculonodular lobe from the posterior lobe. This is the folliculonodular lobe. Number 1 is the folliculus, and number 11 is the nodule. Folliculonodular lobe, and this is the posterior lobe. So anatomically, there are 3 lobes, anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and folliculonodular lobe on the inferior surface. There is another fissure here. This is number 4. It's called the horizontal fissure. This fissure separates the superior surface from the inferior surface. So the 2 important fissures are primary fissure and the posterolateral fissure. Primary fissure separates the anterior lobe from the posterior lobe. Posterolateral fissure or uvulonodular fissure separates the folliculonodular lobe from the posterior lobe. This is the superior surface of the cerebellum. So number 2, the median part, is the vermis. Number 1, the peripheral part, is the cerebellar hemisphere. This is the anterior notch surrounding the brain stem. This is the midbrain, crest cerebri, substantia nigra, tegmentum, and this is the cerebral aqueduct. Number 8 is the posterior notch containing falx cerebelli. Number 3 is the primary fissure. This primary fissure separates the anterior lobe from the posterior lobe. Okay? This is the inferior surface. The inferior surface, this is the inferior vermis. This is the nodule. This is the uvula. This is the pyramid. This is the tuber. Okay? The fissure between the nodule and the uvula is the uvulonodular fissure. This uvulonodular fissure is also called posterolateral fissure. it separates the folliculonodular lobe from the posterior lobe. The folliculonodular lobe is formed of the nodule and the two folliculi. So the three anatomical lobes of the cerebellum, anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and the folliculonodular lobe. The cerebellum is connected with the brainstem by three cerebellar peduncles. It is connected with the midbrain. This is the midbrain, the back of the midbrain. It is connected with the midbrain by superior cerebellar peduncle. It is connected with the pons by the middle cerebellar peduncle. It is connected with the medulla by the inferior cerebellar peduncle. I will talk about the cerebellar connections in another lecture. Regarding the histological structure of the cerebellar cortex, the cerebellar cortex is formed of three layers. The superficial layer is the molecular layer. Second layer is the Purkinje cell layer. And the third layer, or the inner layer, is the granule cell layer. The molecular layer, this is the molecular layer. It contains nerve fibers and the nerve cells. The nerve fibers are axons of Purkinje cells. Okay, sorry, dendrites of Purkinje cells and axons of granule cells and also dendrites of Golgi cells. It contains basket cells near the Purkinje cell layer and stellate cells near the surface. So the cells in the molecular layer are basket cells and stellate cells, the nerve fibers, Purkinje cell dendrites, and Golgi cell axons, and the granule cell axons. Okay, and the Golgi cell dendrites. Again, the molecular layer contains nerve cells, basket cells, and stellate cells. Fibers, Purkinje cell dendrites, Golgi cell dendrites, and granule cell axon. The Purkinje cell layer contains the bodies of the Purkinje cells. The granular layer contains granule cells and Golgi cells. So the nerve cells in the cerebellar cortex are Purkinje cells, basket cells, stellate cells, and Golgi cells, and granular cells. All these cells are inhibitory, except granule cells are excitatory. So the granule cells are excitatory to Purkinje cells. Other cells are inhibitory. Golgi cells are inhibitory, Purkinje cells are inhibitory, basket cells and stellate cells are inhibitory. So the cerebellar cortex is formed of three layers: molecular, Purkinje, and granular. The molecular layer contains Purkinje cell dendrites, granule cell axons, Golgi cell dendrites, the Purkinje cell, and also it contains basket cells and stellate cells. Purkinje cell layer contains cell bodies of Purkinje cells, and the granule cell layer contains granule cells and Golgi cells. Then the cerebellar white matter. This is the cerebellar white matter. Cerebellar white matter contains three structures: deep cerebellar nuclei, four deep cerebellar nuclei, phagid, talk about them, and the fibers leaving the cerebellum, and the fibers entering the cerebellum. The four deep cerebellar nuclei, from medial to lateral, phagid, vestigial nucleus, globose, embolliform, and dentate nucleus. Globose and embolliform nuclei are called interposed nuclei. So the first structures present in the white matter, four cerebellar nuclei: vestigial nucleus, globose nucleus, embolliform nucleus, and dentate nucleus. Fibers leaving the cerebellum. Fiber leaving the cerebellum are two: axons of Purkinje cells, and they are inhibitory, and axons of the deep cerebellar nuclei, which are excitatory. So fibers leaving of the cerebellum are inhibitory fibers, Purkinje cell axons and excitatory fibers, deep cerebellar nuclei axons. Fibers entering the cerebellum are two: climbing fibers and these climbing fibers synapse with Purkinje cell dendrites, and they are exclusively olivocerebellar fibers. Second, the fibers are called the Mousy fibers. These Mousy fibers synapse with granule cells, okay, and they are non-olivocerebellar fibers. So if we compare climbing fibers with Mousy fibers, climbing fibers are exclusively olivocerebellar fibers. They synapse with Purkinje cells and they are excitatory to Purkinje cells. Regarding Mousy fibers, they are non-olivocerebellar fibers. They synapse with granule cells and they are excitatory to granule cells. Again, if we compare climbing fibers with Mousy fibers, climbing fibers are exclusively olivocerebellar fibers. Mousy fibers are non-olivocerebellar fibers, like spinocerebellar fibers. Okay? Climbing fibers synapse with Purkinje cell dendrites. Mousy fibers synapse with granule cells. Climbing fibers and Mousy fibers, both of them are excitatory cells. Climbing fibers excitate Purkinje cells and Mousy fibers excitate granule cells. Regarding the four deep cerebellar nuclei, from medial to lateral, the most medial is the vestigial nucleus. This vestigial nucleus is connected with the vermal zone of the cerebellum. Second one is the interposed nuclei, or globose and emboliform nuclei, and they are connected with the paravermal zone. The fourth one is the dentate nucleus, and this dentate nucleus is connected with the lateral zone of the cerebellum. So the four deep cerebellar nuclei: vestigial nucleus connected with the vermal zone, interposed nuclei are connected with the paravermal zone, and the interposed nuclei are globose and emboliform. The dentate nucleus is connected with the lateral zone of the cerebellum. Regarding the arterial supply of the cerebellum is supplied by three arteries, one superior and two inferior. Superior cerebellar artery, ICA, or anterior inferior cerebellar artery, and the PICA, or posterior inferior cerebellar artery. Let's talk about the origin and the distribution. Superior cerebellar artery is branched from the basilar artery. ICA is branched from the basilar artery. PICA is branched from the vertebral artery. Distribution. Each artery supplies a surface and a peduncle. The superior cerebellar artery supplies the superior surface and the superior cerebellar peduncle. ICA supplies the anterior part of the inferior surface and the middle cerebellar peduncle. PICA supplies the posterior part of the inferior surface and the inferior cerebellar peduncle. Then let us talk about the divisions of the cerebellum. The cerebellum is divided anatomically into three lobes. This is the primary fissure, separating the anterior lobe from the posterior lobe. This is the superior surface. And the third lobe is on the inferior surface, the folliculonodular lobe. So anatomically, we have three lobes: anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and the folliculonodular lobe. Longitudinally, there are three zones. This is the first zone, it's called the vermal zone, which is connected with the vestigial nucleus. This is the paravermal zone, which is connected with the interposed nuclei. And this is the lateral zone, which is connected with the dentate nucleus. Then functional zones are three. Okay, let us talk again about the anatomical divisions. This is the primary fissure on the superior surface, and this is the posterolateral fissure on the inferior surface, and this posterolateral fissure is called uvulonodular fissure. This is the anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and the folliculonodular lobe. So anatomically, we have anterior lobe, posterior lobe, and the folliculonodular lobe. Longitudinal divisions are three: vermal zone, paravermal zone, and the lateral zone. This vermal zone is connected with the vestigial nucleus. This paravermal zone is connected with the interposed nuclei, and this lateral zone is connected with the dentate nucleus. So the vermal zone is connected with the vestigial nucleus. The paravermal zone is connected with the interposed nuclei. The lateral zone is connected with the dentate nucleus. Regarding the functional divisions are three. This is the first functional zone. It is the folliculonodular lobe, formed of nodule and two folloculi. And this folliculonodular lobe is connected with the vestibular system. Therefore, the function of this lobe is equilibrium. The second functional division is the spinocerebellum. And the spinocerebellum is formed of the vermal and the paravermal zones. This spinocerebellum is connected with the spinal cord. Therefore, it is concerned with muscle coordination and the maintenance of muscle tone. The third functional division is the lateral zone, which is the corticocerebellum. This corticocerebellum is the lateral zone of the cerebellum, and it is connected with the cerebral cortex. Therefore, the function of the lateral zone is the automatic control of movement. So functionally, the cerebellum is divided into folliculonodular lobe or vestibulocerebellum, paleocerebellum or spinocerebellum, corticocerebellum or neocerebellum. So the functional divisions are three: folliculonodular lobe or vestibulocerebellum, paleocerebellum or spinocerebellum, neocerebellum or corticocerebellum. Formation of each lobe. The vestibulocerebellum is formed of the nodule and the two folloculi. Spinocerebellum is formed of the vermal and the paravermal zone. Corticocerebellum is formed of the lateral zone of the cerebellar hemisphere. Regarding the connection, the vestibulocerebellum is connected with the vestibular system. The spinocerebellum is connected with the spinal cord. The corticocerebellum or neocerebellum is connected with the cerebral cortex. Therefore, the function of the vestibulocerebellum is maintaining equilibrium. The function of the spinocerebellum is regulation of muscle tone and the muscle coordination. And the function of the corticocerebellum is automatic control of movement. Therefore, the cerebellum has three main functions. The three main functions are equilibrium, and this is the function of the folliculonodular lobe. Second function is coordination, muscle coordination, and the regulation of muscle tone, and this is the function of the spinocerebellum, the vermal and the paravermal zone. Third function is automatic control of movement, and this is the function of the neocerebellum or corticocerebellum. Automatic control of movement means planning of movement and control the range and the force of movement. Therefore, signs of cerebellar lesion are: number one, intention tremor. Intention tremor is absent at rest, but appears when the patient moves his limb. due to loss of muscle coordination. Disturbance of muscle coordination causes ataxia, and the ataxia is in coordination of trunk and limb muscles. Nystagmus is in coordination of extraocular muscles. So simply, nystagmus is ataxia of extraocular muscles. And scanning speech. Scanning speech is in coordination of muscles of speech. So disturbance in muscle coordination may lead to ataxia or nystagmus or scanning speech. Dysmetria. Dysmetria, disturbance in the range of movement, either hypometria or hypermetria. And to test dysmetria, do the finger nose test. And then disturbance in initiation and determination of movement. It's called dysdiadochokinesia, such as pronation, repetitive pronation, and supination. Again, signs of cerebellar lesion are intention tremor. This tremor, cerebellar tremor, is absent at rest, appears when the patient moves his limb. Disturbance in muscle coordination may be manifested by ataxia, nystagmus, or scanning speech, dysmetria, hypometria, or hypermetria, disturbance in the range of movement, and then disturbance in initiation and determination of movement. How to test cerebellar function? Simply, finger nose test. This is normal, okay? So this is normal, finger nose test, and this is abnormal. This is hypometria. This victim, okay, she failed the test because she was caught while drunk during driving. And thank you very much. Best wishes and good luck. And see you in another lecture with cerebellar connections.